Welcome to First Presbyterian Pine City Online. I'm so glad you're joining us today. Our prayer is that this service will inspire you to take your next step in your walk with Jesus. You can connect with us throughout the week on our Facebook page or on our website, firstprespinecity.org, where you can also watch or listen to past messages. You'll find opportunities to give there as well and help support the ministries of our church. Just go to the website and click on the appropriate button. Well, we are looking forward to gathering again in person for worship beginning next weekend. Sunday, January 31st at 10 a.m., we'll be together and we're going to be kicking off a brand new series called This Is Us, and you won't want to miss it. Right after the worship service, we're going to have a brief congregational meeting beginning about 11:15. And this is our once-a-year annual meeting for all of our church members. If you're unable to attend in person, you can still video conference via the Zoom app or by phone. You can join us. Just let us know in advance so that we can get you the log-on information. Well, now as we begin our service, I want to invite you to take these next few moments. Listen to the words of this next song. And then quiet your mind, open your heart to what God might want to say to you today.
Vast, unmeasured, boundless, free. Oh, it's rolling like a mighty ocean in its fullness over me, in its fullness over me. Underneath me, all around me, the current of your love, leading onward, leading homeward, to my glorious rest above. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, vast, unmeasured, boundless, free. Oh, it's rolling like a mighty ocean in its fullness over me, in its fullness over me. How he watches o'er his loved ones, died to call them all his own. How for them he's interceding, watching them from heaven's throne. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, vast, unmeasured, boundless, free. Oh, it's rolling like a mighty ocean in its fullness over me, in its fullness over me. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, vast, unmeasured, boundless, free. Oh, it's rolling like a mighty ocean in its fullness over me, in its fullness over me. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, vast, unmeasured, boundless, free. Oh, it's rolling like a mighty ocean in its fullness over me, in its fullness over me.
We've been talking in this series about what it's going to take to have a better year than last year, which I think we'd all agree is a worthwhile goal to shoot for, even if it's kind of a low bar given last year. The first week, we talked about the importance of consistency over time and how consistency with God's strength is going to get you a lot further than just intensity or trying hard, which is what we usually opt for. Then last week, we looked at letting go and discerning what there is in our lives that we've been holding on to that's slowing us down and keeping us from getting traction in the important areas of our life. Today, we're going to look at a principle, really kind of a law, that will impact whether or not 2021 is indeed a better year for you or not. And we find this principle articulated by Jesus in Luke chapter 6. Jesus is talking to a crowd of people in what is known as the Sermon on the Mount. And here's what he says, beginning in verse 43. He says, "No good tree bears bad fruit, nor does a bad tree bear good fruit. Each tree is recognized by its own fruit. People do not pick figs from thorn bushes or grapes from briars." And Jesus is starting here with a point so profound and so simple, people miss it all the time. Like, what kind of fruit does a fig tree produce? Figs. And people are like, well, duh. But Jesus explains the analogy. He says, "A good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart. And an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in his heart. For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of." And here, he's specifically addressing the things that we say or what comes out of our mouths, but it really applies to all of our behavior. And it's a result of what's in us. What Jesus is getting at here is what might be called the law of the tree, which is just this. What's going on inside the tree determines what gets produced outside the tree. And what I want to do is what Jesus does and apply this to you and me. See, here's the big idea. There is inside of us a constant flow or stream of thoughts and feelings going on all the time. You can think of your mind like it was a string. And on the string, there are a bunch of beads. Every bead is another thought. And there's always a feeling associated with each thought. All the time, there's a stream of thoughts and feelings going on inside your mind. Right now, your mind is working kind of like this. You think, what did Jesus mean when he said this? And you look down at your Bible and you notice your hands and you think, look at my nails. I'm still biting them. That's a bad habit. I hope no one sees. I feel kind of embarrassed. I did that at work because I think my boss is mad at me. I'm kind of worried about that. Man, I get mad at him. You know, I'd like to tell him off sometime. Boy, that'd be something if I told him off. Gee, I'm kind of getting a little hungry. I wonder what I'm going to eat later on today. Hey, Rob's still talking on the video. He sure talks for a long time. Wish he could wrap it up. Maybe I can fast forward. Okay, that's your mind. That's your mind, and you're having a series of thoughts, and they're just going on all the time. Sometimes it feels like you're not. Some days, you have a whole day, and it feels like you've had maybe one thought all day long. But in reality, the mind is never still. The inside of the tree is never still. You're having thoughts and observations and perceptions and ideas at a staggering rate, such that we don't even remember the vast majority of them. This starts to get to the point that Jesus wanted to make. See, your thoughts and feelings take on certain patterns or certain tendencies that inevitably determine the fruit that you bear, the kinds of things that you say, and the things that you do. And when we describe people, when we give them labels or adjectives, really what we're just describing are the patterns of thoughts and feelings that flow inside the tree. Loving people are simply the kind of people who have loving thoughts and feelings. Cranky people are just people who have bitter, resentment-producing thoughts. That's what it means when we think about each other's characteristics and personalities. Over the last 40 years, so many studies have demonstrated this that the single most dominant movement in American psychology has come to be known as cognitive psychology. And it's built around the idea that the way you think is the most important thing about you. The way you think determines your attitude, determines your emotions, it governs your behavior. Scientists are discovering that it has a lot of influence over your vulnerability to illness. The inside of the tree, the flow of thoughts and feelings, is what determines your life. Therefore, Jesus says, if a person is going to be transformed, the inside of the tree is what must be changed by God. Jesus' brilliant insight is this. If you aim only at doing what's right and avoiding what's wrong, that's a setup for failure. This is where there was a major difference between Jesus and a lot of the religious leaders in his day who focused mostly on behavior, just doing right things. Instead, Jesus is saying you must aim at becoming the kind of person who wants to do right things because they make sense to you, because you see them as good and wholesome and attractive. You genuinely don't want to do wrong things because they are unappealing and sad. The whole focus is on the inside of the tree. Jesus' goal is not that you have all these feelings of resentment and hostility and bitterness and so on, and you just kind of learn how to hold them in so they don't come out. His target is to transform the inside of the tree. In our day, we might put it like this. There's a huge difference between kingdom living and behavior modification. And this is the key point. See, the fundamental mistake that people make in spiritual life, and it was true for the Pharisees and it's true in our day, the fundamental mistake people make in spiritual life is that people aim at changing or managing their behaviors. This is an area we get sidetracked as parents. Sometimes we worry so much about getting the proper behavior out of a child that we neglect to address how we can help shape the character of the person. We fall into the trap of focusing only on outside obedience, basically behavior modification. It's like the little girl who wouldn't sit still and her mother finally told her, "If you don't sit down in that chair right now, you're going to get a spanking." And the girl sat there and she began to smile, and the mother asked her what she was smiling about. And she said, "Well, I'm sitting still on the outside, but I'm running around on the inside." See, what must be changed are not just behaviors. Aim at behaviors, and it's a setup for failure. Now, there's a second law here that's kind of a corollary to the first one. The second law that Jesus talks about is what might be called the law of exposure. Jesus says that good people store up good things inside, and then other people store up evil things. We're storing up things in our inner life all the time. Good, bad, true, false, noble, or demeaning. And the idea here is that your mind will most think about whatever you most expose it to. Whatever enters your mind repeatedly occupies it and over time fills it. Then it is expressed in what you do, in your character, in your life. What you put into it determines what you get out of it. It's kind of like if you have a high-performance car You wouldn't put cheap gas in it. Instead, you put the highest octane, most expensive gas you can find into it. Or nobody decides to run a marathon and then goes on a diet of all donuts and chocolate. Like, I wish you could do that. I'd be like running a marathon a week, trust me. Or when people have kids, they're very careful about what goes into that baby, especially the first child. They're real careful about what they put into them. You know how it is with the first kid. With your first kid, when their pacifier falls out of the mouth, like the mom picks it up and puts it in a pot of boiling water and sterilizes it, pulls it out with tongs and waves it around to air dry it before gently putting it back into the child's mouth. With the second kid, the pacifier falls out, she runs it under some cold tap water, dries it off with a dish towel, and gives it back. Third kid drops the pacifier, mom picks it up, spits on it, rubs it off, sticks it back in the kid's mouth. Not a big deal. That's kind of the exception, but as a general rule, we're quite careful what we put into something that's valuable to us. We know that what we put in it determines its performance and well-being. That's why it's so ironic that in the most important area of all life, our minds, people regard this principle, this piece of wisdom, with a casualness that's astounding. The law of exposure, of mental storage, is as unbreakable as the law of gravity. Now, the law of gravity doesn't surprise anybody. Nobody steps off a 10-foot ledge, falls 10 feet, and goes, "Gosh, what were the odds of that? I never thought it would happen." But people violate the law of exposure all the time. They act as if it comes as a total shock. So we've got a society that says, well, if you're a woman, you have to look a certain way. You have to be incredibly slender in order to be attractive. And then we raise a generation of young women who are bombarded by that message and grow up thinking, well, I've got to starve myself to be valuable. And we wonder, well, how did that happen? It works the same way with people. I tell students all the time, be careful about who you choose as your friends because you become like the people you spend time with. And that's not just true for students, it's true for all of us. If you hang out with people who complain all the time or gossip all the time or cheat, pretty soon you'll be complaining or gossiping or cheating. But it's not just the people you're exposed to that you're impacted by. The events you attend, the materials you read or don't read, the music you hear, the images you watch, the social media you're on, the conversations you hold, the daydreams you entertain. These are shaping the little beads that run across the string of your mind. And ultimately, these shape your actions and your character and your destiny. I want you to notice something about this teaching of Jesus in Luke's gospel. None of Jesus' statements are commands. He's not giving orders here. Here's what Jesus does a lot. He simply observes how things are. A certain kind of tree comes from a certain kind of fruit, or a certain kind of fruit comes from a certain kind of tree. You store stuff up, that's what comes out. He just observes, hey, that's the way life works. And therefore, you can decide what you want to do with his teaching. What you do depends on the kind of tree you want to be. You will store up certain inner realities, and from there, the results are utterly predictable. So what I want to do is kind of walk through three options, three kinds of minds that people can cultivate. Option one, maybe your goal is debauchery, lechery, and depravity. Kind of sounds like a law firm, doesn't it? See, the good news, if that's the kind of mind you want to cultivate, it's not difficult. Just be careless about what you put in or don't put into your mind. One of the most brilliant analyses of this kind of mind was written a couple thousand years ago by the Apostle Paul. Here's what he says in Romans 5. It says, those who live according to the sinful nature have their minds set on what that nature desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind controlled by the sinful nature is death. The sinful nature is hostile to God, so it's typified by a certain kind of thought. You go through the day, and you see somebody, and you think, well, that person's more successful than me. Kind of makes me feel bad. I hope they fail at something. If they fail, I'll feel better. The guy driving next to me has a more expensive car than I do. He must be pretty greedy. Or the guy driving next to me has a junkier car than I do. I didn't think anyone had a junkier car than me. He must be pretty low functioning. I'm late for this meeting. I didn't allow enough time to get there, but I'll just say I was late because the traffic was bad. I'll spin the truth to manage people's impressions. See, if you live with that kind of mind, the moods that will dominate your life will be resentment, unresolved anger, anxiety, chronic fear, and unsatisfied desire. Those are the moods that'll dominate a mind from which God is excluded. The key to maintaining this kind of inner life is found in the Psalms. Psalm 10:4 says, "In his pride, the wicked man does not seek God. In all his thoughts, there is no room for God." It's not hard to cultivate this kind of mind. All you have to do is avoid contact with anything that would disrupt this flow of thoughts. So avoid scripture. Avoid wise, honest people who know you deeply and would speak truth to you. Avoid the teaching of God's word. Avoid honest self-examination. Avoid contact with people in need who might move you to compassion. If your goal is debauchery, lechery, and depravity, you just drift. Just drift in our culture. There are ways. These are the ways you find yourself thinking. Sociologists have found that you can predict the social community behavior of people by just asking, what are they doing primarily to feed their minds? If this is the option you're going for, mostly what you have to do is just make sure there's no room for God in your thoughts. In our culture, that pretty much means you just drift. So many people don't take seriously the inside of the tree. That's option one. Option two, if your goal is to be a mediocre Christian, then you kind of do a half and half deal. And the Bible talks about this too. In the book of James, there's a description of a person who's called double-minded. And part of that person is pulled in a God direction, and part of them isn't. And I think this kind of position puts people in the worst of all worlds. See, you live with a low-level, hidden, chronic debauchery, so you're frustrated by all the fun that you think people in the major league debauchery professionals that they're having. But you just maintain enough spiritual or religious input that you have chronic low-level guilt about the amount of depravity that you're maintaining. How do you do that? Well, you just get sporadic spiritual input. Go to church sometimes. Read the Bible every once in a while, but without clarity in how you want it to challenge your mind. Or have occasional superficial conversations with Christian friends. But mostly, fill your mind with the things that everybody fills their mind with. What a sad thing it would be if that were where we were to live. What a sad life to live. But you can do that if you want. There's a third option. It's possible for you to have a transformed mind. Paul puts it like this, and there are many statements like this throughout the New Testament. He says, "Let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus." There is a mind where God the Father is always present, and he just gradually crowds out foolish ideas and misguided intentions. And this new mind is absolutely key to spiritual transformation. That's why Paul says, "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed." How? Not by changing your behavior, but by renewing your mind. As a church, how do we pursue this transformation? It's real simple. We go into the mental storage business. Paul talks about this in his letter to the Christ followers in the church at Philippi. He says, "Whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Let your mind dwell on these things." How would you like to have a mind that has streams of thought like that running through it all the time? If I want to go into the mental storage business, the greatest resource that people have ever found for that business is the Bible. My recommendation is this. Take one thought from the Bible early in the day. Maybe it relates to something you struggle with, like fear or anger. Take one thought from Scripture and let it stay with you all day long. Just let it linger with you. to keep bringing it back to mind. And what happens is you begin to memorize Scripture. Then what happens is that as you take it in, you start to meditate on Scripture. Meditate is a word that can kind of be scary for people. They wonder, like, well, isn't that kind of weird? Isn't that kind of like an Eastern thing? Don't Buddhists meditate? Dallas Willard said, they do, but they eat breakfast too. It's still a good idea. Scripture has a lot to say about meditating. In the very first psalm, the psalmist says that people who love God delight in God's word, in God's law, and they meditate on it day and night. It's really a simple thing to do. Do you know how to worry? If you know how to worry, you know how to meditate. Meditating is kind of like positive worry. You just allow that thought to come back in your mind, and it come back in your mind, and come back in your mind again and again. That's all meditating is. My suggestion is you take verses or short passages and write them down. Put them on your desk at work, put them in your calendar or on the mirror or on the refrigerator. Go into the mental storage business. And as you do that, get real intentional about what you're going to store up in your mind and what you're not going to store up. Decide, I'm going to limit my exposure to the things that take my mind away from God. When you watch TV or go to a movie or listen to music or read a book or go online, just ask yourself, is this true? Is it noble, right, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, praiseworthy? When you talk to your friends, where do your conversations go? Are they filled with gossip, with negative, critical thoughts? Ask yourself, what are the sources that produce the kind of thoughts in my mind that are filled with the characteristics of Philippians 4:8? What are the sources of the thoughts that pull me away? Where do I need to begin to say, I'm going to restrict my exposure to that stuff? I'm going to start getting intentional around the laws of exposure. I was thinking about this not long ago as I was sweeping out my garage. Do you ever wonder, especially in winter, where does all that dirt come from? I didn't bring it in intentionally. I didn't bring it in all at once. I just drove on roads that weren't very clean, and I picked up a little dirt each time. You can't drive around on dirty roads and not get some dirt on your vehicle. It's the law of exposure. And the dirt began to accumulate in my garage. Never set out to have a dirty garage, and I realized it was time to sweep up the garage. I need to be careful where I drive and to clean up the garage when I track in dirt, because the garage was created to be primarily in the vehicle storage business, not the dirt storage business. What would happen if all of us were to go into the mental storage business? You wouldn't have to focus on just trying to do the right things. That kind of life would just flow out of you because of what's going on inside of you. We're in the mental storage business. We're in the cultivating a new inside of the tree business. And when you begin to do that, this year will be better for you and it'll be better for the people around you. Guaranteed. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for your word and this insight from Jesus that reminds us that what goes into our minds and what we think about determines what comes out of us and our behavior. And God, we're so casual with that sometimes. I pray that we would be more intentional about what we fill our minds with and what we keep out of our minds, what we resist and ignore and just don't spend time with. God, help us to focus on you and on your word, so that our lives and our thoughts would be filled with those noble thoughts that you talk about in your word. God, give us wisdom now to know what next step to take, to do with what you've just taught us. And Lord, I just pray that we would have the courage to be able to do it. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.